Amin. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا هادي له ومن يضلل إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، today inshallah we will explain pages 2 to 20 and the first half to 21. We're gonna finish the explanation of Surah Yunus, chapter 10. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us that some of human beings will never believe, even if angels were sent down to them and the dead came back to life, as is the case of the miracle of Isa alayhi salam. He was able to bring back people that had died with Allah's leave, with Allah's power. It's a miracle that Allah has given him. It's not his ability as a human being. We have to understand that. And yet, most people disbelieved in him. So Allah says, and even if we had sent down unto them angels, and the dead had spoken unto them, and we had gathered together all things before their very eyes, they would not have believed. If everything they asked for, give them, like the case of Quraysh, they asked the Prophet ﷺ to break the moon in half and bring it on top of two mountains in front of their eyes. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made that miracle happen, they said it's nothing but magic. So of course they would not have willed, and they would not have believed unless Allah willed, because no one believes except with Allah's will. But most of them behave ignorantly. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the one town that actually believed in its prophet, and Allah did not destroy it. It is the town of Nineveh. It's in today's Iraq, the Mosul. Those are the people that believed in their prophet Yunus alayhi salam. As you know, the story that he warned them that Allah's punishment will strike them if they don't believe. They did not believe in him. He got upset with them and he left. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a trial and caused a big fish to swallow him. And he did not die. And he was making dua, La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin, in the inside of the fish. And Allah saved him from that trial because of his dua. And the Prophet ﷺ said that also us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, saves us from trials if we make the same dua. And then after that, he was thrown from the fish's belly onto land. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused the pumpkin plant to grow on him. The scholars explained that, you know, it has the effect of shooing away the insects so that they don't come onto his skin, because his skin was melted because of the fluids inside the fish's inside. And as the scholars said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent wild beasts that had milk for them to feed Yunus alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reared him until he became better, and then he went back to his people. Scholars said he went back to other people, not his own people, and they believed in him because they themselves saw that the punishment was coming to them, and they started asking Allah for forgiveness for 40 days, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he knew their sincerity and their dua, accepted their repentance and saved them from the punishment. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says here, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم فلولا كانت قرية آمنت فنفعها إيمانها إلا قوم يونس إلا قوم يونس لما آمنوا كشفنا عنهم عذاب الخزي في الحياة الدنيا ومتعناهم إلى حين. Was there any town, any community that believed after seeing the punishment, and its faith at that moment saved it from the punishment, except the people of Yunus? When they believed, removed from them the torment of disgrace in the life of the present world and permitted them to enjoy for a while. So belief at the time of punishment did not help except with the people of Eunice. We saw yesterday that Fir'aun believed also at the time of punishment, but his belief did not avail him none. Also the people of Thamud, when they killed the she camel, their prophet told them that the colors of your faces will change for 3 days and then Allah's punishment comes. So when the punishment came, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not accept the belief of the disbelievers. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, he told Fir'aun, "Al-ana wa qad asayta qabl wa kunta min al-mufsidin." Now you believe, now that you are drowning, now you believe, and before you mocked Musa alayhi salam and you tortured the believers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here says that he made an exception for the town of the people of Yunus. And Allah said, did any town from the previous nations believe in its entirety when they received the messengers? All of the messengers that we sent before you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, were denied by their people. Or the majority of their people denied their messengers. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Yasin, Ya hasratan ala al-ibad, ma ya'tihim min rasulin illa kanu bihi yastahzi'un. Alas for mankind, there never came a messenger to them, except they used to mock at him. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, كَذَلِكَ مَا أَتَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا قَالُوا سَاحِرٌ أَوْ مَجْنُونٌ. Likewise, no messenger came to those before Quraysh, except they said these people a sorcerer or a madman about their prophet. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَكَذَلِكَ مَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ فِي قَرْيَةٍ مِّنْ نَذِيرٍ إِلَّا قَالَ مُتَرَفُوهَا إِلَّا قَالَ مُتَرَفُوهَا إِنَّا وَجَدَنَا آبَاءَنَا عَلَىٰ أُمَّةٍ وَإِنَّا عَلَىٰ آثَارِهِمْ مُقَتَدُونَ. And similarly, we sent not a warner before you to any town, to any people, except the luxurious ones among them said. So it's usually the luxurious people, al-mala', as is mentioned in the Quran about the towns that were destroyed, the people who are in power, the people who are in control of the people's matter, the governments, those are the ones that disbelieve. Why? Because believing in Allah would cause them to become just and not eat up all the wealth of the people and to not have the people become subjugated to them anymore. And this is why they hate the truth. This is why they hate Islam, because they know that if their people accepted Islam, these people in control will not benefit from the worldly benefits, will not enslave the populous masses. They will not be able to devour their wealth. That's why it's usually the luxurious ones, the higher ups in the society, that disbelieve in the messengers and the true message. And that's why every time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a prophet to some people, the luxurious ones among them said, we found our fathers following a certain way in religion, and we will indeed follow their footsteps. So this is their only reason, their only stated reason rather, because that's not the real reason, it is the stated reason for their disbelief. But the actual thing, as we said, is because they're the ones that stand to lose the most if, you know, worldly benefit-wise, if they were to believe in the true message. Also, the Prophet ﷺ said that the prophets were displayed before me. There was a prophet who passed with a group of people. That means a group of people followed this prophet. And a prophet who passed with only one man believed in this prophet. And a prophet with two men. Maybe a prophet, only two men would believe in him. And a prophet with no one. No one believed in that prophet. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made this distinction between the prophets according to Allah's divine will and divine wisdom. Some prophets will have no one follow them, and some prophets will have a huge number of people of followers, such as Musa alayhi salam and Muhammad alayhi salam. عُرِضَ عَلَيَّ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ فَجَعَلَ النَّبِيُّ يَمُرُّ وَمَعَهُ الْفِئَامُ مِنَ النَّاسِ وَالنَّبِيُّ يَمُرُّ مَعَهُ الرَّجُلُ وَالنَّبِيُّ مَعَهُ الرَّجُلَانِ وَالنَّبِيُّ لَيْسَ مَعَهُ أَحَدٌ. Then he وسلم, mentioned the multitude of followers that Musa alayhi salam had, peace be upon him. Then that he saw his nation of people, that means the Muslims, then he mentioned the multitude of followers that Musa alayhi salam had, peace upon him. Then that he saw his nation of people filling from the west to the east. In other words, the Prophet saw that Musa had a huge number of people. So the Prophet asked, is this my ummah? They said, no, this is Musa alayhi salam. He has a huge number of followers. And then he was shown his ummah, and he was much bigger than the ummah of Musa alayhi salam. The point is that between Musa alayhi salam and Yunus, none believed except the point is that between Musa alayhi salam and Yunus, there was no nation that believed in its entirety in its prophet, except the people of Yunus. So only the people of Yunus are the ones that believed in their prophet in entirety. And the people of Yunus are the people of a town called Nineveh in Iraq. And it's in today's Mosul. And they only believed, the people of Yunus believed because they feared that the punishment from which their messenger warned them might strike them. They actually witnessed its size. You know, the size of the punishment started. So they decided to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They cried to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and asked for help. They engaged in humility in invoking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They brought their children and cattle and asked Allah to lift the torment from which their prophet had warned them. As a result, Allah sent His mercy and removed the punishment from them and gave them respite. And this is actually also in the Salat al-Sisqa, the prayer that the Muslims make for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring down rain. Usually a Muslim is ordered to put his clothes inside out as a means to show humility before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to bring the children with you and to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in humility. And asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to lift the drought from the Muslims. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers the dua most of the time, if not all the time. But of course, then you have some hypocrites in the Muslim lands that mock this practice. And they say, oh, actually, when they realized that rain was coming, they go and they made this type of salat so that they can say that Allah answered their dua. There are hypocrites. What else can we say? That's not the case. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers the dua of the Muslims, answers the dua if the person undertakes the necessary steps for the dua to be answered, such as eating food that is halal, sleeping in a bed that is halal, living in a house that is halal, that everything that he takes is halal, and he obeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then his dua will be answered. And the opposite is also true. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِلَّا قَوْمَ يُونُسَ لَمَّا آمَنُوا كَشَفْنَا عَنْهُمْ عَذَابَ الْخِزِّ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَمَتَّعْنَاهُمْ إِلَىٰ حِينٍ. Except the people of Yunus, when they believed, we removed from them the torment of this grace in the life of the world and permitted them to enjoy for a while. So in interpreting this ayah, Qatada said, no town has denied the truth and then believed when they saw the punishment, and then their belief benefited them, except the people of Yunus. When they lost their prophet Yunus alayhi salam, and they thought that the punishment was close upon them, Allah sent through their hearts the desire to repent. ثُمَّ تَابَ عَلَيْهِمْ لِيَتُوبُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that allows people to make tawbah. Allah knows what's in the hearts of His slaves and knows who deserves guidance, who deserves misguidance. So the people of Yunus wore woolen fabrics. They're rough fabrics to show their humiliation and their humility before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They separate each animal for its offspring so that, you know, the animals are calling for their offspring. So, you know, everyone is in a state of sadness and a state of humility before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can answer the dua of these people who are in hardship. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about His noble self, that He answers the dua of those who are in hardship. And subhanAllah, even the kuffar, even the disbelievers, sometimes when they're in hardship, they sing a lot of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for a dua, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers their dua. أَمَّا يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَى. Who is he that answers the dua of the one who is in a hardship? Of course, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful. Allah decreed on His noble self mercy. And he, subhanahu wa ta'ala, said in Hadith Qudusi, my mercy preceded my anger. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he sees these actions from his slaves, then he subhanahu wa ta'ala brings down his mercy to them and saves them from the punishment as it happened to the people of Yunus. And this is why the Muslims should repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They should stop disobeying Allah. They should stop imitating the disbelievers. They should stop celebrating New Year, celebrating Christmas, celebrating all types of disbelieving holidays. And then ask, why are we being tortured and killed in many places of the world? Why are we backwards? This is the reason why, because of our sins. Not only do we commit sins, but all of a sudden we say that they're not sins, they're halal. No, we are sinners. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made our enemies victorious over us because of our sins, as the Prophet ﷺ said. And we will not leave this humiliated state except if we repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and go back to the true religion. So repentance is something that everyone is asked to do at an individual level and also at an ummah level, so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can show us his mercy and can bring us back the honor that we deserve as an ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he saw the truth in their hearts and that they were sincere in their repentance and their regrets, he removed the punishment from them. Qatada said it was mentioned that the people of Yunus alayhi salam were in Nineveh, the land of the Mosul, as we said in today's Iraq. This is also a report from Ibn Mas'ud, Mujahid, Sa'id bin Jubair, and others from the Salaf. Next, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ لَآمَنَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ كُلُّهُمْ جَمِيعًا أَفَأَنْتَ تُكْرِهُ النَّاسَ أَفَأَنْتَ تُكْرِهُ النَّاسَ حَتَّى يَكُونُوا مُؤْمِنِينَ وَمَا كَانَ لِنَفْسٍ أَنْ تُؤْمِنَ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ وَيَجْعَلُ الرِّجْسَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ. And had your Lord willed, those on earth would have believed, all of them together. So when you then compel mankind until they become believers, it is not for any person to believe except by the leave of Allah, and he subhanahu wa ta'ala will put the ridges on those who do not have reason, who do not use their mind, who do not think correctly. It is not part of Allah's decree to push people, to force people to believe. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ. And if Allah had willed, meaning O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if it had been the will of your Lord, he would have made all the people of the earth believe in what you have brought to them. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has wisdom in what he does. Similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ لَجَعَلَ النَّاسَ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً وَلَا يَزَالُونَ مُخْتَلِفِينَ إِلَّا مَنْ رَحِمَ رَبُّكَ ولذلك خلقهم وتمت كلمة ربك لأملأن جهنم من الجنة والناس أجمعين. And if your Lord has so willed, he could surely have made mankind one ummah, but they would not cease to disagree except him on whom your Lord has bestowed his mercy, and for that he did create them. And the word of your Lord has been fulfilled when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that surely I shall fill hell with jinn and men altogether. Because when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cast shaitan, we seek refuge with Allah from him, and may Allah curse him. Iblis said, I shall surely misguide most of the progeny of Adam alayhi salam, even though you preferred Adam over me. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, go, whomever among the mankind follows you, then surely hellfire is going to be their abode, and what a just requital. And then Allah says, my true worshippers, my true slaves, you have no power over them. So the majority of mankind are disbelievers and will go to hellfire. As the Prophet ﷺ told us in hadith, he says, 1% of the people will be in Jannah, 99% will be in hellfire. This if we don't take into account the nations, the two Turkic nations of Gog and Magog, Ya'juj and Ma'juj. They are actually Turkic nations. The people that Gog and Magog used to abuse were also Turkic people, and so are Gog and Magog, as the scholar said. So if we take Gog and Magog into account, It's one out of 1,000 to Jannah, 999 to Hellfire, as the Prophet ﷺ said. Without these two nations, it is one person in Jannah, 99 people in Hellfire. So do not be fooled by the sheer number of evil in the world or people that follow evil, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did tell us that. قُلْ لَا يَسْتَوِي الْخَبِيثُ وَالطَّيِّبُ وَلَوْ أَعْجَبَكَ كَثْرَةُ الْخَبِيثِ. Evil and good are not equal. Even if you are mesmerized by the abundance and the sheer number of evil. Evil is usually rampant. It's everywhere. But don't be fooled by the fact that there's so much evil in this world. It doesn't mean that that evil is actually good. Evil, it is what it is. It is evil and it will remain evil. So the exception is also always for a few people. وَمَا أَكْثَرُ النَّاسِ وَلَوْ حَرَصْتَ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ. Even if you are very eager to do so, most mankind will not believe. So here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and if your Lord had so willed, he could surely have made mankind one ummah, but they will not cease to disagree, except him on whom your Lord has bestowed his mercy, and for that he created them. And the word of your Lord has been fulfilled by saying subhanahu wa ta'ala, surely I shall fill hell with jinn and men altogether, those disbelievers among them. He also said, أَفَلَمْ يَيْأَسِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْ لَوْ يَشَاءُ اللَّهُ لَهَدَى النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا. Have not then those who believed yet known that had Allah willed, he could have guided all mankind. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to, he would have guided all of mankind. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Muhammad السلام, so will you then compel mankind and force them to believe? أَفَأَنْتَ تُكْرِهُ النَّاسَ حَتَّى يَكُونُوا مُؤْمِنِينَ. Until they become believers, meaning it is not for you to do that. You are not commanded to make sure that people believe. All you are commanded to do is to show them the truth. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in the Quran, there are two types of guidances. There is hidayat al-irshad wa hidayat tawfiq. The guidance of showing a person the truth. This is the guidance that Muhammad ﷺ does. He only shows people, this is the true path of Allah, this is what you do, this is what to do. And then there's the guidance of tawfiq, that means guidance of a person actually becoming a believer. This is in Allah's hands. This is in Allah's hands. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides the people's hearts. You can show people the truth, but you really can't make them believe. It's only in Allah's hands that these people believe, because he knows what's in their hearts. If they deserve guidance and eternal bliss, or they deserve hellfire, because he's the one who created them and he knows what's in their hearts. Because it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who sends astray whom he wills and guides whom he wills, because he knows what's in people's hearts and he knows who deserves what, because he's the one that created them. يُضِلُّ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ فَلَا تَذْهَبْ نَفْسُكَ عَلَيْهِمْ يُضِلُّ مَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Allah sends astray whom he wills and guides whom he wills. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَا تَذْهَبْ نَفْسُكَ عَلَيْهِمْ حَسَرَاتِ. So do not destroy yourself in sorrow for them because they did not believe in your message. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, it is not up to you to guide them, but Allah guides whom he wills. لَيْسَ عَلَيْكَ هُدَاهُمْ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, maybe that you would kill yourself with grief because they are not believers. But Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted goodness for all mankind. He wanted everyone to believe. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling him that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is wise and he has wisdom and he decides according to his wisdom who deserves to be guided and who deserves to be misguided. لَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعٌ نَفْسَكَ أَلَّا يَكُونُوا مُؤْمِنِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also said, إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتْ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. You do not guide whom you like, but Allah guides whom he wants. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَإِنَّمَا عَلَيْكَ الْبَلَاغُ وَعَلَيْنَا الْحِسَابُ. Your duty, O Muhammad ﷺ, is only to convey the message, and it is up to us to reckon, to guide, to misguide, to punish, to reward. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَذَكِّرْ إِنَّمَا أَنْتَ مُذَكِّرْ لَسْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ بِمُسَيْطِرْ. So remind them, you are only one who reminds people. You are not a dictator over them. You don't force them to become believers. There are also other ayat besides these which prove that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the doer of what He wants, guiding whom He wills, leading whom He wills astray, all out of His knowledge subhanahu wa ta'ala and His wisdom and justice. Similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا كَانَ لِنَفْسٍ أَن تُؤْمِنَ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ وَيَجْعَلُ الرِّجْسَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ. It is not for any person to believe except by the leave of Allah, and He will put the rijis on those who do not heed the warnings, do not use their mind, do not use their brain. It is not for any person to believe except by the leave of Allah, and He will put the rijis. What is rijis? It is disorder and misguidance. Disorder and misguidance upon those who do not reason. Meaning Allah's proofs and evidences are clear. And He subhanahu wa ta'ala is just in all matters, guiding whom He wills to guide and leading whom He wills astray. Because as we said many times, Allah knows who wants to be guided and Allah knows who wants just the worldly benefits. Next, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قل انظروا ماذا في السماوات والأرض وما تغني الآيات والنذر عن قوم لا يؤمنون فهل ينتظرون إلا مثل أيام الذين خلوا من قبلهم قل فانتظروا إني معكم من المنتظرين ثم ننجي رسلنا والذين آمنوا كذلك حقا علينا ننجي المؤمنين. Say, behold, all that is in the heavens and the earth, but neither ayat nor warners benefit those who do not believe. Then do they wait save for the likes of the days of men who passed away before them? Say, wait then, I am waiting with you among those who wait. Then we save our messengers and those who believe. Thus it is incumbent upon us to save the believers. The commands reflect upon the creation of the heavens and the earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the exalted, guides His servants to reflect upon His blessings. What Allah has created in the heavens and the earth is part of the clear signs for those who possess correct understanding. From that which is in the heavens are the luminous stars, the firmaments, the moving planetary bodies, the sun, the moon. This also includes the perfect succession of night and day, their alternating and their merging so that one is long and the other is short. Then they alternate through the year so that the long one becomes short and the short becomes long. Likewise, from the signs in the heavens is the rising of the sun, its vastness, its beauty, and its adornment. Also, whatever rain that Allah sends down from the heavens, thereby bringing the earth to life after its death and causing various types of fruits, crops, flowers, and plants to grow, is from the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever Allah creates in the earth from the various species of beasts with their different colors and their benefits for man are signs. The mountains, the plains, the deserts, civilizations, the structures, the barren lands of the earth are also signs. Then there are the wonders of the sea and its waves. Yet it still has been made subservient and submissive to those who travel upon its surface, the sea that is. It carries their ships, allowing them to traverse upon it with ease, going from continent to continent. This is all under the control of the most able, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no God worthy of worship except Him, and there is no true Lord other than Him. Allah says, with all these signs, for some people that don't believe, neither ayat nor warners will benefit them. وَمَا تُغْنِي الْآيَاتُ وَالنُّذُرُ عَنْ قَوْمٍ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. This means, what thing will benefit such disbelieving people in addition to the heavenly signs and earthly signs? and also the messengers that came with the miracles, with proofs, with the evidences that clearly prove the truthfulness of their message. And yet they choose to disbelieve. What else do they want? All these are signs that anyone with a clear mind would believe in. But these disbelievers reject that, reject all of that. And this is also similar to Allah's statement about some people who don't believe, even though all the signs are shown to them. Surely those against whom the word of your Lord, the word of the Lord is that they shall enter hellfire if they disbelieve, has been justified with not believe. Truly those against whom the word of your Lord, which is the punishment in the hellfire for the disbelievers, has been justified against them, because Allah sent them messengers, signs in heavens and earth, and they still don't believe. Therefore, they can't claim ignorance. They can't claim that they did not know. They can't claim that no messenger came to them. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ حَقَّتْ عَلَيْهِمْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ وَلَوْ جَاءَتْهُمْ كُلُّ آيَةٍ حَتَّى يَرَوُوا الْعَذَابَ الْأَلِيمَ. Also concerning Allah's statement, فَهَلْ يَنْتَظِرُونَ إِلَّا مِثْلَ أَيَّامِ الَّذِينَ خَلَوْا مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. Then do they wait, save for the likes of the days of men who passed away before them? Meaning, those that reject you, O Muhammad, are they just waiting for us to destroy them and punish them the same way we destroyed the people that belied their messengers before you, the people of Ad, Thamud, Nuh, etc.? Then tell them, if you deny my message and say the punishment is not coming, then wait then. I am waiting for Allah's decree between us, among those who wait. And Allah, of course, at the end, will save the messengers and those who believe from the torment. قُلْ فَانْتَظِرُوا إِنِّي مَعَكُمْ مِنَ الْمُنْتَظِرِينَ ثُمَّ نُنَجِّي رُسُلَنَا وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كَذَلِكَ حَقًّا عَلَيْنَا نُنْجِي الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. This means, verily, we destroy those who reject the messengers, but it is incumbent upon us to save the believers. This means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put it aright on His noble self to save the believers from the disbelievers. This is also similar to Allah's statement that He put it upon Himself, His noble self, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He shall be merciful with His slaves. Your Lord has written, prescribed mercy for Himself. Next, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ إِن كُنتُمْ فِي شَكٍّ مِّن دِينِي فَلَا أَعْبُدُ الَّذِينَ تَعْبُدُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ وَلَكِنْ أَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ الَّذِي يَتَوَفَّاكُمْ وَأُمِرْتُ أَنْ أَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَأَنْ أَقِمْ وَجْهَكَ لِلدِّينِ حَنِيفًا وَلَا تَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ وَلَا تَدْعُ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ مَا لَا يَنْفَعُكَ وَلَا يَضُرُّكَ فَإِنْ فَعَلْتَ فَإِنَّكَ إِذًا مِنَ الظَّالِمِينَ وَإِنْ يَمْسَسْكَ اللَّهُ بِضُرٍّ فَلَا كَاشِفَ لَهُ إِلَّا هُوَ وَإِنْ يُرِدْكَ بِخَيْرٍ فَلَا رَادَّ لِفَضْلِهِ يُصِيبُ بِهِ مَن يَشَاءُ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ وَهُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Say, O people, if you are in doubt about my religion that I came with, Muhammad speaking, I will never worship those whom you worship besides Allah. Rather, I will worship Allah, the one who calls you to die. And I was commanded to be one of the believers. And I was commanded, direct your face toward the monotheism religion, the Hanif religion, the religion of Ibrahim alayhi salam, singling out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship, and not be one of the idolaters. And do not invoke besides Allah, do not make dua besides Allah, what would not benefit you nor harm you. All these graves that people worship, statues, prophets, angels, jinn, all these things that people worship will not benefit you nor harm you. Because if you did, then you would certainly be one of the wrongdoers. You would have committed polytheism. And if Allah touches you with harm, there is none who can lift it but He. If harm touches you, make dua to Allah. Don't go to the graves, don't go to the statues. And if He subhanahu wa ta'ala intends good for you, then none can repel His favor, which He subhanahu wa ta'ala causes to reach whom He wills among His servants. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his favor to reach us. And he subhanahu wa ta'ala is the pardoning, the merciful. The command to worship Allah alone and rely upon him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to his Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, say, O mankind, if you are in doubt about the correctness of that which I have been sent with, the Hanif, monotheism, religion to worship Allah alone, the religion which Allah has revealed to me, then know that I do not worship those whom you worship besides Allah, or the statues and the false deities that you are worshiping, I'm not worshiping it. Rather, I worship Allah alone, ascribing no partners to him. He subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who causes you to die, just as he gives you life. Then unto him is your final return. If the gods that you call upon are real, I still refuse to worship them. So call upon them and ask them to harm me if you are truly saying the truth. And you will see that they can bring no harm to me, nor benefit. Not to me, not to you. In other words, Muhammad is telling the people, look, if you're saying that your gods are true, I'm not worshiping them. So tell your gods to harm me. Of course, your gods won't be able to harm me because they can't even harm themselves nor benefit themselves. I only worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because he is the only one who holds the power of harm and benefit, and he subhanahu wa ta'ala has no partners. And I was commanded to be one of the monotheistic believers. وَأُمِرْتُ أَنْ أَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Concerning Allah's statement, وَأَنْ أَقِمْ وَجْهَكَ لِلدِّينِ حَنِيفًا. And you should direct your face towards the Hanif religion. This means make one's intention in worship solely for Allah alone, being Hanif, singling out Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship. Hanif means the one who turns away from associating partners with Allah. For this reason, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا تَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. And do not be one of the idolaters. This statement is directly connected with the previous statement, and I was commanded to be one of the believers. So, Muhammad alayhi salam, Allah told him, tell the people I was ordered to be a Hanif, monotheistic, to be one of the believers and not to be one of the idolaters. Next, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِن يَمْسَسْكَ اللَّهُ بِضُرٍّ. And if Allah touches you with harm, this verse contains the explanation that good, evil, benefit, or harm only come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And no one shares with Allah's power over these things. Therefore, he is the one who deserves to be worshipped alone without ascribing any partners to him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَهُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. And he is the pardoning, the merciful. This means that he subhanahu wa ta'ala is the forgiving and merciful towards those who turn to him in repentance, regardless of what sin the person has committed. Even if the person committed shirk, polytheism, and he repented, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would forgive him. Next, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ قَدْ جَاءَكُمُ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ فَمَنْ اِهْتَدَى فَإِنَّمَا يَهْتَدِي لِنَفْسِهِ وَمَنْ ضَلَّ فَإِنَّمَا يَضِلُّ عَلَيْهَا وَمَا أَنَا عَلَيْكُمْ بِوَكِيلٍ وَاتَّبِعْ مَا يُوحَى إِلَيْكَ وَاصْبِرْ حَتَّى يَحْكُمَ اللَّهُ وَهُوَ خَيْرُ الْحَاكِمِينَ. Say, O people, now the truth has come to you from your Lord. So whomever receives guidance, he does so for the good of himself. And whosoever goes astray, he does so at his own expense and his own loss. And I am not set over you as a guardian. And follow what is revealed to you and be patient until Allah gives judgment, and he is the best of the judges. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands his Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to inform the people that that which he has brought them from Allah is the truth. It is a message concerning which there is no doubt or suspicion. Therefore, whomever is guided by it and follows it, then he only benefits himself by doing so. Likewise, whomsoever is misguided away from this message, then he will suffer the consequences against his own self. And I am not set over you as a guardian. This means I am not a guardian over you in order for you to become believers. I am only a warner to you and a guidance. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that has guidance in his hands, subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm only a warner. I'm only showing you the correct path, but it's only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that can guide you. Next, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاتَّبِعْ مَا يُوحَى إِلَيْكَ وَاصْبِرْ حَتَّى يَحْكُمَ اللَّهُ وَهُوَ خَيْرُ الْحَاكِمِينَ. And follow what has been revealed to you and be patient. This means adhere to that which Allah has revealed to you and inspired you with. And be patient, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with the opposition that you meet from the people until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives judgment. This means until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala judges between you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the disbelievers that denied your message. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the best of judges. If this means that he subhanahu wa ta'ala is the best of those who pass judgment due to his justice subhanahu wa ta'ala and his wisdom. This is the end of volume 4. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our good deeds and to forgive our sins. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach us the beneficial knowledge. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us from all trials and tribulations. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring back the Muslims to the correct path. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring back the Muslims around the single leader that will guide them back to getting back what was lost from them and to take them back to becoming the leaders of mankind in goodness. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to lift the injustice from all the Muslims throughout the world. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure the sick among us and to have mercy on the dead among us. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure my mother in the shortest terms. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure her in the shortest term. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure in the shortest term. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive all of our sins and to keep us on the straight path until we meet him. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make the best day of our existence the day that we meet him and to gather us with Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu salam in the paradise of al-Firdaus. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.